everyone. Good morning. Welcome. Welcome. Good well, it's morning to us. Triforce Podcast.
Hello, Lewis. I'm glad to be here. How are you doing?
I can't help doing some TV show entry. Welcome. I'm good. How are you doing, Sits? Have you had a good week? You had a busy week? What have you been up to?
Yes, I have actually had a great week, Lewis. It has been fantastic. No, it's been pretty good. What have I been up to? I haven't really been up to much, just the use. Been playing games online with people, sometimes without. I've been streaming a lot of it, and occasionally I do a couple of tweets, which is kind of fun too. And we did a staycation. We did our last staycation of the year. With the lockdown and stuff, we took the kids and we stayed at a local hotel for one night. It was fun.
Which hotel?
It's good fun.
Tell us about it. Did it have a little mini bar? I'm starved for information.
No, it didn't have a mini bar. It had a fridge though. It had a little fridge that we could put milk in for the kids. They like to drink.
Did it have
milk.
A little kettle? British kettle.
It had a little kettle. Yes, it sure yeah. did.
Because people can't go away without their cup of tea. I'm just drinking one.
It had a
right
beach view, which is not hard over here because everywhere you look, there's a beach pretty much. But it was nice still. It was pretty good. It had parking, crucially. It had on-site parking. We didn't have to park somewhere stupid to get there.
Not unusual for a hotel. I'm trying to think if I've ever stayed at a hotel that doesn't have parking.
Well, over here, there's some that don't
have
any.
There's a couple. Yeah, I've stayed in a few. Especially
or if they do have parking, it is...
City hotels.
Really, really shit parking. So it was nice to have good parking. It had an indoor pool. And a fitness center and stuff. That was nice. Of course,
did
I didn't
you make
use...
use of that?
No, of course not. I
of course
felt
not.
Kind of sick even thinking about it, but it was nice facilities to have. And
I always think whenever I go to a hotel with a fitness center, I'm always like, oh yeah, do you know what? When I go on holiday there, I'm going to get up in the morning and I'm going to go to the gym. And I don't think I've ever been in one. Like ever.
When if I go somewhere and stay at a hotel, the only exercise I'm doing is masturbating, pretty much. I mean, that's
wow.
That's it.
I thought you guys didn't do that.
Well, this is old me, new me. New me wouldn't do that now.
No. Shout out to the Yorkshire Tea Biscuits.
Yes.
Doug had brought me in. So Doug came in the other day and was like, oh, I've got something for you. And he patted like his pockets, right? Like his jacket pockets. And I was like, what the fuck is this? And he pulled out just a tea bag, like a loose tea bag. And dropped it on the desk. And I was like, okay, first of all, that's just come straight out of your pocket, right? I feel like he didn't even like put it in like a bit of kitchen roll or anything, okay? And he was like, smell this. I was like, well, I don't want to smell anything. It's just come out of your pocket. But anyway, so I picked it up and it's like one of these Yorkshire tea biscuit tea bags that they've been talking about that taste like custard creams or
whatever.
Whoa,
just give me a cup of tea. Fuck. Well,
the idea of it's like imagine you, it's a cup of tea where you dip the biscuit in and it breaks apart and you get all those scummy bits in the bottom, but you don't have to do that anymore because the tea just skipped
I'm
a
not
step.
Being funny. If you dunk biscuits in your tea, to me, you are a commoner. Well, it's common.
It's a technique.
It's common.
It's very comforting. It's fine. I was talking to Harry this week about how he had a build around and he started slipping into local draw,
Bristolian,
you know, local Bristol
dialect,
slang
yeah.
and stuff, you know, right. because you want to seem like a normal everyday kind of guy.
Not a meme lord. Did he say Pager or Poggers at any point or?
Unlikely. Man, unlikely.
Your boiler's fixed. Poggers, mate.
There's there are limits for that kind of stuff, right? But my mother-in-law is not like really old school in the sense that she's overly a prude or anything like that. You know, like she wouldn't like think that it was gross to see like boobs on TV or something like. You know what I mean? She's not like easily offended, sort of thing.
It's like my mum and dad secretly watched Game of Thrones but didn't tell anyone because they were worried that people would judge them for it because they know it has swearing and boobs and stuff in it, right?
Lots
and they have a certain standing to uphold, you know, in the local community.
Lots of
so they didn't even want to tell me.
Mr. Brindley, I hear you've been watching that program with breasts in it. What? No, no, I would never look at a pair of woman's breasts on the television. That's disgraceful behavior.
Never what? Even seen Mrs. Brindley's breasts. I ensure to avert my gaze whenever she enters or exits the show.
My mum used to change the channel if there was even a hint of anything sexual happening. And this was in the 90s and the 80s and the 90s. They didn't even allow swearing on television after 9 o'clock. Every film was like,
yeah, famously,
Melon Farmers and Flip This. And there was nothing. If there was a pair, if a woman started to undo anything or a guy leaned in to kiss and it was clear something was going to happen, she would change the channel.
You had the dubbed swearing. In North America, they dubbed over the swearing. So like Die Hard, if it was on, because of the time zones and stuff, it didn't really matter what time it was on. Yeah. They would just dub over the swearing. So
Screw you, Melon Farmer. Yippee-ki-yay,
Mr. Falcon.
And it's just like, so bad.
Yeah. Honestly, you're completely right. This is what I... So last week we talked about Twin Peaks, and then I watched the movie.
What do you think of the movie? It's kind of nuts, isn't
it? The movie just... It's basically like made me realize that the TV show was just like you said, it was all censored and Melon Farmer and like so, but so much that it came across as a kind of hokey, soapy, kind of dark comedy stuff. I didn't think of it as dark. And Sips and everyone always refers to Twin Peaks as dark. And I was like,
the core story is about abuse.
Because
and
it's got that lighthearted 90s sort of soapy background. It doesn't feel as. And then the movie. The first scene, there's like tits everywhere.
Yeah.
Laura Palmer's got a baps out in every scene. There's like people, like it's much, much more.
Well, like as you learn more about her, you realize that she was like really going off the rails because of like.
Everyone's doing cocaine
because
in every
of abuse,
scene. It's like so gratuitous. Like the amount, they must have gone through like 4 or 5 bags of whatever they'd use instead of cocaine. I assume they don't use sugar or flour because that would be. What are they snorting up their nose?
Real cocaine. I mean, they got to. They're in character. I mean, you have to.
That was
the
90s.
Method.
Because they honestly, they were going at it like it was running out. Yeah. They were just cranking that stuff.
Flour or something.
They were snorting it in every hole, and it was quite something. So I watched the Twin Peaks movie, and then I watched Twin Peaks: The Missing Pieces, which is. The bits that got cut out of the movie.
Right. And
so
what about the books?
Two more hours.
Did you get the books? There's two books that are really
I haven't
good.
Had time. We've only had a week since this last podcast.
Oh, man. I would have blasted through all that shit in
2 hours movie, another 2 hours movie, and I watched the first episode of the new Sims 2017.
God. The Return.
Which was another 2 hours.
Oh.
I was like, fucking... It was ages.
Oh, the Return is so fucking good.
I was
good.
Sat
Wait
in front of the TV the whole time. Oh, The Return is so bizarre because some people have like massively, massively aged and had kids, you know, like you guys have. You know, you guys 20, 25 years ago were young, supple, youthful young babies, right?
Yeah,
and if you hadn't had kids, you would still be much better, apparently. Like, I think this is it. Like, some of the actors haven't fucking aged a day.
Well, yeah, but some of them have died, like, and recently some have died as well. Like, what's his face? I can't remember his name now. He's the bald Secret Service agent. I don't know if you've seen him in The Return yet.
Albert or whatever.
Yeah, he died recently.
Oh, no. I like him.
Norma died as well, you know, but
a log lady.
Norma at the diner. Do you
ever find out why she has a log or not?
Log lady?
Well, she's sort of spiritual.
Yeah, she's just
sort of in tune with the forest. And so she's actually, she's one of the rare characters. So in the sort of David Lynchian style, the maddest characters tell the most truths.
Yeah.
Kind of thing, you know?
You know, it's funny, you were talking about drugs. I watched a show called 24 Hours in Police Custody, which more interesting than it sounds. It was done in quite an interesting style. There was no narrator. It was all told through the characters, not characters, the real people. And it was about this drugs bust where the shipment of heroin comes into Britain in a van, and they'd hidden it in what looked like very innocuous items. So there's these things called spider catchers, or these cheap plastic things for catching spiders. I don't know.
Sure.
And at the bottom of it was 5 kilos of heroin. And they thought, okay, let's let this go to where it was meant to go, and we'll just put bugs and recording devices and everything and see what happens.
Oh, put spiders in
and
it.
And they found these guys, and essentially the way they, the damning piece of evidence that they had was that one of the guys, one of the key guys who they could not tie to this case, had a dash cam that automatically turned on when he locked his car. Every time he locked his car, the dash cam turns on, presumably in case someone crashes into your car while it's parked or tries to nick it or something. And they seize this and they're looking at it, and it's an HD recording from his car of this drug deal and him turning up. And I was blown away that the guy who's like, this guy has an encrypted phone. He's very careful. It's all super careful. And yet he's just recording and apparently not realizing it. Every single thing that happens over the past few weeks is just on his dash cam. It was amazing. And it was really interesting because the police have this weird kind of respect almost for these actual criminals, because they keep talking about them in these glowing terms, like, oh, they're really careful, they're very smart, you know, it takes a lot to catch them and everything. But then when they came to book him in, he called them sir, he was very polite, they apologized that then when they'd arrested him, it was his son's birthday, they didn't mean that and everything. And it was like, whenever I've watched these police shows before, they arrest some goon and the guy's like, I'll fucking have you, like smashing stuff up and pissing everywhere. Yeah. And you can tell the police aren't impressed because they're like, if you were an actual hardened criminal, you would know at this point, the jig is up. There's no point being a twat. I'm going to go to prison. That's part of it, you know. And they just, it's almost sort of part of the business. But it was such a big case. It was like one of the biggest drug cases in that area, like ever.
Fuck.
And they found out that over that time, we're talking over a ton of drugs had been smuggled in by these guys with this system. And they only caught them on the last few, but they'd smuggled in 39 shipments. So they'd been doing this for a while. And as usual, they're all living large. He has a business as a front, but it makes no money. And I was thinking, surely there's a smarter way to deal with this than literally having a farm, having the drugs delivered to your farm, and then doing it and going in person and doing it all from there. I was kind of surprised that high level of drug deal was so easily busted, as he had his dash cam on and he was there doing the deal. So I was trying to come up with ways, if I was going to become a drug baron, which I'm obviously not, how would I do it? And I'm thinking drones. That was the first thing I thought of.
It's harder to do with drones now. They're on it. They figured out that people try to use drones and they're
and you learn nothing, P-Flax. It was the technology that fucks him. You want to get rid of all technology.
Yeah.
You want to go back to horses and carts and cats and dogs. You want to
paper
use like
and pencils.
You want to use like no technology, no traceable tech. You have to
you
get
can't
rid
trace
of
a drone.
Amish. Well,
how are you going to trace a
you
drone?
You have to become Amish. That would be the most successful drug.
How are they going to trace a drone? Hey, let me tell you
everything
my plan.
Is fucking tracked.
Can I tell you my
plan? Trackers
can I
tractors
tell you my
shit?
Plan before I, before
please,
you shoot it
do.
Down? Because you're shooting down my high level drug empire here.
Drone.
Before,
I'm shooting your drone down. That's what I'm fucking
it's
doing.
It's just it's in the embryonic stages. It's in the planning stages. All right, so I would have like a drop house. I would employ a homeless man to stay in that house. I never meet him directly. We send him money every month to just stay in the house and receive deliveries. When he receives the
where
delivery.
Where are you sourcing this trustworthy homeless man?
Already I've detected flaws in your plan, but carry on.
Well, just a man that can't be traced to me. Just some guy. Like, I don't want it to be.
Okay.
And also,
you've already got another person involved. These are elementary.
This guy's got
mistakes.
Nothing. The way I figure it, he's motivated. I'm sending you money every week. We know where he is. We're watching the house. He can't fuck us. But he takes the drugs from the delivery. We just post it. Amazon postage, whatever. Comes in. He unwraps, he puts it on the back porch. A drone comes in, picks up the drugs, and flies them to a waiting vehicle some way away. And I've got, like, surveillance of the area. They can't run after a drone. And it's going over a bunch of fields and stuff. There's no way they can get there. If there's a helicopter in the air, we don't fly. If there's any kind of, you know, any kind of police activity in the air, we don't fly. I pick it up in my drone, I drop it off in the van. This is not my van. This is some other homeless guy I've hired. I've got a network of homeless people working for me, and there's no connection between me and the drugs. They take it to the drop-off point. I have no contact.
Welcome to Triforce News. Today, criminal mastermind Ted Forsyth was arrested after his drone was spotted carrying a kilo of cocaine across neighboring fields.
No offense to homeless people, but I feel like having not just one, but two homeless people so integral to your logistics network means that it's failed already. Because I don't think you can trust those homeless people to do a good job.
All they have to do is this. Hello, parcel. Oh, thanks. Take parcel.
They'll fuck it up. They'll fuck it up.
Then we kill them.
They'll find a way.
No, I don't think it is this. I think it's the opposite. So there was this. The homeless people, believe it or not, are like really good sources of like if they're really good like sources of getting criminals. Because there was that case, wasn't there, where the guy robbed the bank. Do you remember? He hired people on Craigslist to come and like hang out outside the bank. And there was the money van pulled up. He grabbed the money and ran off and got on a boat that he did. He like a blow up boat and ran down the river. He had this whole heist, right?
Yeah.
It was quite famous in America. And he got foiled because a week earlier he'd been doing a practice run and a homeless man had been poking around in the stuff he'd left in an alley. And he came along and was like, "Oi, what are you doing with my stuff?" And the homeless man wrote down his number plate. And then when he actually did the robbery a week later, the homeless man still had it. And he got the guy. The guy had planned out this perfect crime and would have gotten away for it if it wasn't for the good
if it wasn't for like, those meddling hobos
of Sherlock Hobo. Yeah.
And all it took was here, I'll give you like a nickel for some information. And he was like, okay. And he gave up everything. And that's
right,
what's going to happen
my
to the two that are working in your logistics network.
They never meet me. When do they ever
meet
me?
No, but other people, they're easily swayed.
You can't also assume that homeless people are criminals either. That's like a real bad stereotype.
No, you're right.
They're not necessarily
likely to get involved. I'm not saying that they're criminals. I'm just saying that they're not.
No,
they're not trustworthy.
But my point was that I need someone that is motivated by money to a point where they would do a job like that. They're not going to quit. Because the alternative is they live on the street.
Just ask people on Fiverr. Just get like random people on Fiverr.
I trust them even less. I would trust the noble hobo over a twat on Fiverr.
Right.
Yeah, but they don't, as long as they don't know you.
Can I suggest?
How are you going to meet a hobo digitally? Oh, but then you can't leave a digital footprint.
Can I suggest that instead of using a homeless person, you use like a young teen? Because if for some reason shit hits the fan, they can't really be arrested or go to jail. Like, it's hard.
Like a kid.
Because they're kids. Yeah.
They're not going to look favorably on you, though, if you're corrupting the youth of tomorrow. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, but then you're turning them into a loyal
I was trying to think. The reason I chose a homeless person is because I want someone with no ties and no reason to go to
the
police.
I love how Sips is trying to make a mafia family and like adopts these like kids and make them into made men.
Works.
And
it's just build tried, like tested, a tested and true.
Yeah. I don't trust kids. Well,
hiring homeless people and putting them in positions where there's like something at stake or responsibility is a huge no-no. Nobody would ever do it. But like a 12-year-old kid. An impressionable 12-year-old kid, probably better, honestly, and won't be able to take as much heat.
All right, what if we hired a drug addict?
No, never hire a drug addict to do anything.
They'll be thinking about
all the time is drugs and how they can steal drugs from you or steal money from you to get drugs or when they're going to be next doing drugs.
You can't
drugs.
Even have accomplices because everyone can't... Honestly, like, no one could keep a secret. Like, if you've told... If you've told more than one, I think maybe one person could keep a secret. But if you've told two people, there's no way that secret's going to stay secret. Like, everyone's going to know. This is how these criminals all get got. They have their little gang.
Yeah.
One guy gets drunk and tells his girlfriend, and then she tells her mates at the pub, and everybody knows then, and the whole town
But that's
knows.
Why I'm saying that I want my entire setup to be on the end of my encrypted phone. I never actually meet face-to-face with anybody. It's all arranged. And none of the people I work with are people that I've ever met or know.
You know what you
but
could
that's
do
the
further?
Problem is how do you get to that position?
As well, I wear slippers and a bathrobe and wander around the streets acting confused all the time to throw them off as well. So like, you're smart and you've got everything sewn up and everything is running smoothly. And they'll never suspect you because they just think that you're crazy bathrobe guy.
I also think you also have to have a regular job and keep normal hours and appear in every other way to be a perfectly normal person.
Yeah.
So in the evening, you arrange all this stuff. But these guys do it full time. And they're very obvious. They like once you start looking at this guy, it's like, his business never makes any money, but he drives all this flash stuff. Where'd this money come from? It's like,
that's the other thing.
Guy.
You can't spend that money on flash stuff
because
it'll draw too much attention. So you still have to drive around your old banger and
And I guess at that point,
and the house coat and stuff,
it becomes, why am I doing this?
Yeah.
If I have to live like this, I'm just thinking as a retirement fund.
Yeah.
And you just, they did so many of these runs. I think if they just stopped earlier, they would never have been caught. Mm-hmm. But they got greedy as usual.
Yeah.
I think it has to be like, for me, like the it seems to have to be like the whole, you have like the onion router, whatever the onion, I've never actually used the onion browser. I understand that it's like an encrypted browser though, where you can look up drugs, right? You can buy drugs right. and stuff if you wanted to, right?
Yeah.
You can find like these online marketplaces, like they're like two clicks away. As I understand, I've never, again, I don't know what I'm
is
doing.
Is this so the if, dark if you're web?
More well informed.
No, you, yes. you do sound like you don't really know what you're talking about.
I sound like my dad right now, but I understand that you can buy basically anything. You could buy prescription drugs, you could buy illegal drugs, you could buy fucking pre-rolled weed sticks, whatever.
Weed
right?
sticks? Good yeah. heavens. Do you, excuse me, Mr. Drudge, do you have any weed sticks? Pre-rolled, because I don't know how to roll. Oh, what a weed
well,
stick
I ain't got
is,
time to roll my
own
weed.
I would like
weed.
A weed stick.
Why, yes, I do, young man. In fact, I have 69 weed sticks here and another shipment of 420 weed sticks coming in tomorrow.
Would you show me how to blaze it, please?
I will show you how to blaze it, and I will show you how to praise it as well, young man.
So first of all, no one is gonna, there's no chatting, right? They just mail it to you in like a sealed package.
Right.
I think that's the way to do it, just through the fucking Royal Mail. That's how they got that diamond, the world's biggest diamond, back to London, didn't they? Do you remember we talked about this? It's when they found it, they were like, they chartered a ship at a private like security firm to like bring it back on the boat. But that was all just a decoy. They actually just put it in the post.
Amazing. Yeah.
You know, and it just went through the normal postal system and got back to London just fine. You know, I like that. And that's how the drugs should be done.
Do they have dogs at the depot that sniff every package?
Yeah.
Yeah, but
they do, yeah.
A lot of them are wrapped in like, and there's loads of ways to foil those dogs because you use vinegar and stuff and other things.
Yeah.
They have like ways
but
to
then
like,
don't you have a dog that sniffs vinegar?
Yeah.
Well, no, but they're always one step ahead, you know, the drug dealers.
Well, you go vinegar, they go chili sauce. You go chili sauce, they go pepper. You go pepper,
well, you don't
they
want
go
to make it delicious. You don't
roses.
Want to slather it in meat paste, P-Flax. No. That's not going to help, no. is it?
I didn't say meat paste. I don't think dogs like... I don't think
these
dogs
are
would.
These dogs are trained, though. They don't really care if they smell
your
meat paste.
Your dog doesn't
they're,
like meat paste.
They're trying to sniff specific stuff.
She would eat meat paste.
You sure it's a dog?
My dog, if I open the dishwasher and a drop of water falls, like condensation from the dishwasher, she will leap off the sofa and run over just in case
yeah.
it's food. I was like, it's a drop yeah. of water. You have water. Why are you staring at me for dishwasher drops? She's so gutsy.
Always want more... food.
Similarly, food. If there is even one flake of shit in their asshole, they'll lick that out like it's
then
a meal.
Why do you have
well.
To make the dog seem so unpleasant? What is that? It's just gross, dude. You don't need to
dogs are lovely.
Talk about it like
I saw
that.
A thing the other day of a dog because daylight savings happened and there was a dog expecting a walk at daylight savings, you know, ready to go,
right.
very excited.
Yeah.
And the owner was like, No. So it's another hour. The park's not open yet. We can't go for another hour. And the dog's like, just has no idea. Because there's no way you can tell that, you know, there's no way you can communicate through dog language that the park's not open. My heart fell a little bit for that pupper, right? Because you got to think, well, I hope the owner just played with him for an hour or something. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Or something.
Listen, I never got a chance to finish what I was going to say about my mother-in-law. Can we... I know it's been a while, but...
We're going back to the start.
We're talking about tradesmen coming in and Harry adopting the local lingo to speak
right,
to
right,
them
right,
whatever.
Right, right, right.
And I was saying that my mother-in-law... What I was going to say was my mother-in-law had a tradesman in. It was a plumber. Plumber came in because she didn't have any hot water. She woke up. She didn't have any hot water. So she was like, fuck, okay, I'm just going to phone this plumber. So the plumber comes out, has a look and stuff. And, you know, he seemed like a pleasant guy. Like, my mother-in-law is pretty old school. She, like, offered him a cup of tea and stuff. And then he was like, oh, excuse me. Would you mind if I used your bathroom? I really need to take a piss. And my mother-in-law was just like, excuse me? Like, he was just like, I think it's because he said the word piss instead of, like, you know, just leaving it, you know, just saying like, can I just use the bathroom? But because he said piss, this offended her greatly. And she actually had to phone the place that sent him out and complain.
Right.
And she's never done that before. You know what I mean? Like, she's pretty...
The word piss.
She's pretty laid back and easy going.
I'll be honest with you. I don't really care for the word piss unless it's being used in a comedy sense. Like, it's not a pleasant way to say you need the
word. It's a horrible word. It can be funny in context, if for a joke or whatever. But this was not. This was like,
though.
This is this guy's vocabulary generally. It must be.
I worked
so
with a guy.
So just like, I really need to take a piss.
I don't say it, but I say I need to pee.
Yeah.
I really need to pee.
Yeah, I'll say I need to pee, or I'm just going to pop to the loo. I normally say I'm going to pop to the loo.
Yeah,
because that implies I won't.
Do you think that? Do you think that's unreasonable to phone and complain about?
Well, I wouldn't have complained. I wouldn't have phoned.
I say I'm going to pop to the loo and I need to pee.
I mean, she's old though. Like, she's in her 70s.
She's got nothing better to do, is what it is. But no, I wouldn't have complained.
Is it because she spends so much time with your kids that she thinks that kind of language?
I think she was just blown away by like the. She just thought it was really rude.
It's not actually,
but again,
it really isn't
she's
that
not
bad,
like
though.
A she's not an overly prudish person or anything. I think that one just for some reason.
I mean, imagine if he said, "Oh, really, really to take a big shit."
Yeah.
Can you imagine if he said
that?
Well,
I think like, it's not too far off to say taking a piss as well. Like, it's like it is pretty rude, isn't it?
Yeah, I really need to piss and shit.
I personally wouldn't have complained, and I would kind of think, you know, come on, just.
Where's the line, though?
Just roll your eyes or something. But yeah,
there's things over the line, right? What about dump? I need to take a dump.
I need to take a dump.
I mean, here's the thing. I
find it funny but rude as well.
Yeah.
What about number two? I need a number two.
I just don't think you need to say anything.
Yeah, just say I need the loo. Can I use your toilet?
I just need the toilet. Yeah,
can I use your toilet?
Yeah.
That's all. But I wouldn't have complained, but I certainly would have thought, geez, that's a bit coarse.
Yeah,
but
I don't think I would have complained either. But at the same time, I don't blame her for complaining either. You know, like I don't think I would bother to complain. But
right.
I think she's in the right for complaining because it is kind of weird, isn't it? Like to turn up.
Somebody's
house
strange.
And say that.
But like I said, I worked with a guy in the office. He sounded so. I'm just gonna go take a piss, and he'd always drag the S's out. Piss. Like as if we needed the sound effect to oh a piss you mean like yes urinating sorry yes it's like I'm just gonna take a piss and he'd go off and you'd be like geez did he have to
go
say piss
pinch a fucking loaf.
So what was it like fucking I was talking to the Ped and Ravs about this on Saturday and Leo was talking about it as well because she has Japanese lessons right and so she informed us
that's
that
she's a weeb.
The way that you ask in Japan is very much more kind of polite. And I guess it would be like the same of us in English if we were like, do you have a toilet? Or kind of very like, not directly approaching.
Well, so you say
it,
when
you know.
When they built this house, was a toilet one of the rooms that they included in the other
exactly.
rooms?
Exactly.
Yes,
very cryptic.
May I visit
May
it
I
alone?
Please perform a piss sensei.
No. You never ask for it. You just say... do you know, is there perhaps a toilet in this house? But even looser than that.
Oh.
So, yeah, like you said, like...
Well, so you sort of say, like, toilets are interesting, aren't they?
Yeah.
One thing I like to do when I'm in a house, I always like to check out the toilet alone for a few minutes. Oh, would you like to check our toilet out? Absolutely. No, yes, I would. Thank you so much. Like, that is he's so fucking painfully polite, isn't he?
I know. I love that, though. Like, that desperate politeness kind of where you're just trying to work around. But that's one of the things that got the sort of Japanese and Korean sort of pilots into trouble because they found that I've talked about this before, but like their politeness got them into trouble because they wouldn't tell pilots what they would like. There was like they were overshooting the runway or
God.
I don't know, something like that. Do you know what I mean? They'd be like, oh, that runway's looking a bit far away, isn't it? I wonder whether they built that in the wrong place. Do you know what I mean? So they actually were kind of given like training to be direct and standardized. I think they all speak English now as well, which is more, maybe that helps them be more direct, you know, because it's less.
It's definitely there is definitely the room to be polite in English.
There's deferentialness.
I think if you teach
well.
Them the phrases that they need, and those phrases are blunt, those are the ones they're going to use. So if you just teach them, you know, when you would normally say, "Oh gosh, I hope we don't overshoot the runway today. That would be a shame." You know, why don't you just say, "You're coming in too short." That's the English phrase that you need to use. Like, oh, okay, yeah.
We're going to die.
That's the phrase you need. to you. So if you just teach them those blunt phrases, you don't need to worry about them being impolite. They only know how to be blunt. Yeah. There you go.
Man, I love that. Speaking of people being blunt, that some of the dialogue in, have you guys ever seen the movie Whiplash?
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
I watched it for the first time last week. And
really?
I loved it.
I'm sure we
I thought it was
about
great,
it
but man,
it's great.
The people really in it are so rude to each other. It's unbelievable.
They're horrible to each other.
Turn the fucking page. Like, what? I'm just here to have fun drumming. Like, you know.
Yeah, you'd last 2 seconds of that.
Yeah, I would actually be really offended by all of the interactions of all of the characters. I would find that a bit hard to deal with.
I don't know. Like, I really like realistic dialogue, though. Yeah. Like, sometimes, you know, some stuff is so stilted when you watch it. You're like, this is not two fucking people talking to each other. No one talks to each other like this. You know, it's nice when you watch shows that are kind of talky, overlapping talking, like people really do, you know?
You know, that's interesting. I watched, and Lewis, this will feed into your belief that I watch daytime TV, but I watched 12 Angry Men with Glenn Fonda, which is a classic.
I've watched that relatively recently.
Starring Pyrion Flax 12 times.
It's a very, very famous, it's one of these movies that always hits the top 100 movies or whatever you should, these you should always watch.
It's, it's very, very, very good. It's a little dated, but like you said, the conversation.
But not that dated.
No, it's not. I don't feel it's that dated.
Because the court system is very fucking old and shit in the way it's done. Well, not shit, but like very kind of fixed, you know, and it hasn't changed in hundreds of years.
Oh, really, you mean like the system of how the jury works and everything?
The system of court, the jury, because it's still almost identical, really. So many bits of it haven't changed in 70, 80 years.
No, yeah.
You know.
But it's interesting.
How old is that movie?
Oh, gosh. 19? I think it's, like 70, I think it's from the 60s. Old. Yeah. I mean, it's probably 50 years old at this point. But so essentially the deal is that, like, we only see the jury room. That's pretty much the only setting. There's a brief bit in court and there's a brief bit outside court at the ends as to bookend it. But the bulk of the film, like 90% of it, is in this one room. And it's really, really, really interesting. The characters are all different, but not so different that you think. They're not so wildly different that it seems forced. It just seems like a group of 12 random people that have been selected for jury duty. And, you know, they've all got slightly different backgrounds and slightly different opinions. But it just struck me. I've never done jury duty. And it's ironic because I've always really wanted to do jury duty and I've never been selected. And I know tons of people who hated it and never wanted to do it and got selected. All I'm saying is, if you're listening out there, I'll do jury duty. I would love to do
I've
it.
Never done it, and I never want to do it
I've
either.
Never been selected either, actually. I'd like to do it.
Actually, I would have liked to do it when I was working like at a normal job for just some free time
off.
But now I don't want to be selected because I don't want to have to do that. I don't really want to take any time
off
from
my current
job. It's
more difficult to be self-employed, for sure. Like, if you ran a butcher's and you were the only person who made sure that opened
every day. But you can say no. In those instances, you can say no.
Yeah.
Like, if you, like, I think that's what surprises me is it kind of goes to the core of who must be doing jury duty. It must just be old people and the unemployed. Like, well, who else is doing it?
My wife was selected.
Because most other jobs, if you said it. Your boss is going to write and say, look,
I think it's a,
if they leave,
oh my God.
You know, we're going to go bust.
This is a great job for the homeless.
Get them in!
I don't know about that.
Get them in.
You can't trust them. But listen, my...
you can't trust them.
No, you cannot. My, no offense. No offense to the homeless, but they're not... I would not trust them to be jurors.
These Sips' views do not represent
No. I don't think you can trust them
out.
With drug-related jobs, and I certainly don't think that they would make good jurors. That's just my opinion.
I don't know. I lean on the side of we should help people who are down on their luck.
Sure, you should definitely help them, but I don't think step one of helping them is to make them jurors, is all I'm saying.
You don't think?
No. So my wife was selected for jury duty, but she was selected about 2 weeks after she'd given birth to my son, and she was able to get out of it as well. She's like, I'm a new mom. I've got this baby.
Give me a break.
And I really can't do it. And they were like, yeah, sure, no problem. Like, they just like found
someone
else.
I guess it's not quite the same as being conscripted for the war, is it? You know, you could probably,
really.
Like, they're like, well, yeah, all right.
I think the worst would be getting jury duty for like a really big, long ass case. You know, like,
What me and Mrs. F were talking about when we were watching it. That was it. We were like, if you watch the OJ thing, you know, if you look at how long those people were sequestered for, Oh my god!
Oh, like, weeks, yeah.
Yeah, that's your life.
Some of them were going crazy as well, eh?
Yeah,
some of them
were actually just staying in a hotel. Crazy.
Yeah,
awful.
The OJ lockdown, OG lockdown.
And then you saw some of them were just like living it up. They just thought it was the greatest thing. They got to eat at the hotel every day and stuff, and it was just like so.
This is what I'm saying. You know, let's put homeless people in those hotel rooms. Man. You know, We got. I think it kills two birds with one stone, and I'm all down for like those types of initiatives. Like I saw a thing this week where in Sweden they were dropping off like mail and deliveries and stuff with the van, but then in the back of the van they would pick up all the recycling, and I was like, what a genius! In one end, out one end, right. The van is always full. I'm like, come on, this is more these ideas. We need these types of things. I'm just saying, give it a go. Why not?
You know what?
Jury, trial by hobo.
Okay, let's
I choose trial by hobo.
Let's do the trial of homeless jurors when it's you who's in court fighting for your life, okay? That's when we'll do the trial. Are you okay with that?
Well, that'll be fine with me because I'm really nice to them. You're the one who thinks they're untrustworthy.
No. Let's just see how you feel if they're judging you and possibly putting you.
I call
bars.
Sips to the witness stand.
Yeah.
So listen here, Sips. I hear you think homeless people are untrustworthy. do you?
I think they are a bit. Like,
but hold on. Just to clarify, there are lots of different levels of homeless people. There are people who are homeless for economic reasons and they've had some family disaster or they've been forced out of their house and stuff like that. That's one group. Okay. Then you've got the kind of homeless people you get who walk up and show you the contents of their underpants, who piss in front of Waitrose, who do all that kind of stuff that's like, oh my God. And then there's the mentally ill homeless people. Yep. So there are all these different
groups. Who are much more prevalent in America.
Of homeless people. In America, the homeless people seem terrifying to me. And I mean,
they are 100 times crazier and more scary.
And you want to get them on a jury. I mean,
well, I'm not saying we do this in America. Fuck, America's fucked, dude. I'm not trying to fix them. They're on their own.
Right.
They managed to get rid of old fucking Cheeto face. Thank God he's out the door.
So the homeless people you're talking about are accountants that have just fallen on hard times and have somehow ended up on the streets.
A very specific group.
Maybe they got disgraced for sleeping
with
prostitutes.
They still have a working monocle and a fairly fresh top hat and would make excellent jurors is the ones you're talking
about. Yeah, they dust themselves off, put them in a hotel room, get them in a nice bit. Give them a lot of homeless people are actually just unable to get a sort of a start because it's so difficult
to
break that.
I think isn't that the thing they did in Scandinavia where they had all these empty buildings and they essentially gave homeless people apartments, and that makes such a difference in terms of changing the situation because suddenly you can open a bank account and you can receive post, and if someone says what's your address, you can now give an address. And
so
it's like without that base level
are living paycheck to paycheck anyway. Do you know what I mean? Like such a large proportion of our economy is built on people having no savings and no like support necessarily. And you know, if they lose their job, they're gonna lose their house as well.
How
do you get a job?
I think they say people, society is three meals from revolution or whatever, or you know, descending into chaos. But as I understand it as well, most people are like two or three paychecks from the street.
Yeah.
Like that's the way most people live is, you know, you're going to be homeless level.
Anyway, let's move on. Oh my God. So this podcast, by the way, is sponsored by ExpressVPN.
Tell me more,
Lewis.
Oh
my gosh. When you use the bathroom, you always close the door behind you, right? You don't want random.
Depends if I'm at a house.
So why would you let people watch you when you're online, huh? Using the internet without ExpressVPN is like going to the bathroom and not closing the door.
Oh my God, you've scared me.
So I use a VPN. Using ExpressVPN is easy as closing the bathroom door. You just load it up, click a button, and you're protected from prying eyes watching you poo. You know,
I don't want someone watching me poo. That's disgusting.
If you're like me and PFLAX and believe that your online activity is your business, why not secure yourself by visiting expressvpn.com/triforce today? expressvpn.com/triforce. You get an extra 3 months free. and you don't have to
watch FBI people.
Yeah. Yes, that's that is
it. You shouldn't be watching that in the first place anyway, but if you happen to be, well, what can we do about it?
But if you do want to watch Sips Pooping, use ExpressVPN to keep yourself private while doing so.
Please. Yeah. I feel like I'm not the one who needs to worry in that situation, really. You know, I think it's down to other people to be worried about. You know, like,
so you don't close the door when you go to the toilet?
Doing a number two with the door without it, like if I don't have a door, for example, I'm still going for my number two. I don't really care. You know, it's everybody around me who suffers. Yeah,
you're like a prisoner.
Why?
Well, fuck you. When you gotta go, you gotta go. Jeez.
This is completely at odds with the previous toilet chat we've had. So you're telling me that not only would you not let people use your toilet, you would openly shit with the door open because, and I quote you, sir, when you gotta go, you gotta go. Well, apparently not. You should have gone when you were at a place with a
door.
What
are you gonna do? Wait for doors to be in? What if there's no doors?
Tough, mate. What if I'm at your house and I need a shit? I'm shit out of luck then as well, aren't I? Find a door or fucking shit your pants outside.
I kind of feel like that about a lot of things. I think it's because I'm a bit older now. But like, you know, for example, like say you're coming out of the shower, right? And you're walking into your bedroom to get changed. Do you guys do that? Or do you guys take all your clothes into the shower with you?
No.
I have clothes scattered around the house. So sometimes, for example, I'll have to walk naked through the entire flat downstairs.
Okay, and how do you feel about that?
To get a pair of pants that's hanging out.
Okay, so your dick and balls are hanging right out. You're ass naked. You've just gotten out of the shower.
Yeah.
Are all of your blinds closed while this is happening? Or are you just like, fuck, I don't really care. Like, I'm just...
No, not really. Not anymore. No,
I'm the same. Because I feel like, when I was younger, I'd be like, oh, fuck, I got to close the blinds so I don't want anyone to see me naked or whatever. Nowadays, I'm just like, well, if you're looking, it's your fault. Like, you know, I'm just fucking doing my thing here. Like, and that's how I feel about the shitting thing, coming back to the shitting thing. If you're watching me shit, that's down to you. Like, you know what I mean? It's
Why are you fucking watching? Here's the thing. I remember I was at a friend's house one time. We were having a party. This was about 10 years ago. We're smoking out the window, and this guy comes
home. You still had a full head of hair.
I did.
You know,
this guy comes home from, it was more than 10
years ago. Unburdened by the chains of dadhood.
Exactly. It must have been more like 15 years
ago. Pyrion party flax, they called him back then.
Guy comes home from work in a flat over from my friend's flat, and he parks his bicycle in his flat, which I always think is awkward, but if you've got a bike, you know, where else are you going to put it if you're living in a flat? Parks his bike, and then he just takes all his lycra off right there in the middle of his living room with the big light on,
right.
Curtains wide open, just strips off. Although there's like a mixture of blokes and birds watching this out the window. And we see this guy, and we're all just like, oh my God, dude, close the curtains. And all the girls like, woo, you know, sort of thing. And he didn't notice. And I thought, I mean, you're saying if you're watching, then look away. But at the same time, if you just stood in your window naked, being like, well, just don't look, your attitude, I think that's personally extremely self-centered and honestly a little bit sociopathic to think if looking at me do this is a problem, look away, well then why not just shit in the street?
But if they're looking
the same
through
at
my
all,
window,
like,
it's like a horror movie.
You're saying
don't look.
And I think that's
What does shitting in the street have to do with it, though? Nobody's
because
shitting in the street.
Because if you don't like it, just don't look, dude.
Well, yeah, exactly.
But you would be shocked, wouldn't you? But you're saying that you want to have a shit in a toilet with the door open, and if I don't like it, I should just not
I'm
look.
I'm not
that's
saying
weird.
I want to have a shit in the toilet with the door open. I said if there was no doors and I had to take a shit, I would still take a shit.
That's different.
But that's what I was saying.
That's an emergency situation.
Exactly. That's what I was saying the whole time.
I did not hear the word emergency. You're up.
No, I didn't say emergency. I said if there were no doors and I had to take a shit, I would still take a shit.
I think that's true for everybody,
though. Because if somebody is watching, well, what the fuck? I still have to take a shit and there's no doors.
But you would say, there's no door and I need to take a poop and everybody look away. And
I said that.
But then that's not even a thing.
And then you called me a sociopath.
I didn't. I said that telling people, and you guys are now saying walking around your flat naked and if people look, well, that's on them.
Yeah.
I just think it's a bit weird. Why would you do that?
I'm not saying I'm walking around naked on purpose here. I'm saying like for like 5 seconds while I'm leaving the shower to go get changed and I'm naked. You know what I mean? I don't think there's anything wrong with that.
Do you dash or do you just stroll?
I just stroll. I'm not in a rush.
I don't know, P-Flex. Like, for example, if someone had to look in my and this is the case I'm thinking in Sips's house too, like just a casual delivery guy or guy popping round is not going to be able to see me naked, right?
Yeah, you're upstairs, right?
They have to be illegal anyway. They have to have got a ladder or like looking from
another
vantage
house
point
or
have
something.
A telescope.
Yeah.
Like those people with telescopes who perv into other people's houses.
Peeping Toms.
That is what we're talking about.
Oh, geez,
right?
That's so unlikely.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It is unlikely. That's why I'm not dashing to get changed or whatever, because I'm assuming that nobody is really making an effort to look into my bedroom while I'm getting changed.
Right. But okay. So hold on. If you'd been more specific about the scenario, I think it would be different. But it felt like a blanket term. There's no door,
I'm
walking around naked. Well, yeah, but I have to assume.
I'm some sort of exhibitionist who's trying to like have more rights to.
I don't want people to see me naked. I don't want to upset people with my pale, wrinkly, you know, pasty, like horror golem body, right? That's just going to traumatize people. I'm not trying to do that. But I'm saying if they're perving on me, trying to get into looking on me, changing or look into my flat, and they get scarred by it, that's their problem.
Okay.
Do you know what I mean?
I'm
not responsible for that.
If we're putting those layers of caveat on it, what you're saying is, it's deeply unlikely that anyone could see me unless they'd specifically gone out of their way to see me. Is it still okay to walk around naked? Yes, of course. Like, that's not even a question. But when you put it as broadly as, if the windows are open and curtains and everything and you're walking around naked in your flat, is that a problem? Then all the different possible connotations pop into my head of who could look in and what's the flat situation? What are you overlooking, a fucking playground? Who knows?
Listen, no. If you're robbing a bank and you fall through the skylight and break your neck, that's not the bank's fault for that, right? Do you know what I mean? That's what I'm saying.
Right, no, absolutely. But I when you said, when you were asking these specific cases, you didn't put enough groundwork into setting the scene for me. So my imagination ran wild.
Right.
In my imagination, you have a
me
big,
and Sips
big,
are just
big
walking
bay
down
window.
The street.
Yeah,
and
no,
you're
I'm
walking
not.
Around naked.
Fully naked.
You're opening the door to take a shit.
No, I'm not fighting for my right to be naked here. I'm just saying,
right.
If you're making an effort to look into my bedroom where I am naked, which you shouldn't be doing in the first place.
Right.
It's fucking up to you. It's down to you. If you're grossed out, well, that's your fucking fault.
But I don't think that's even an argument, because if I'm looking through your window with binoculars,
I'm
hoping to see naked Sips. That's what I'm...
Well, you might not be. Like, that's the thing.
Well, in that case, you get rewarded for the effort.
Exactly.
Do you know what I mean? I'm all right. It works both ways.
So you're, help, you're,
you know
you're
mean?
Saying
if the bank,
they put in the
if
legwork.
If the bank put a ladder next to the skylight and let criminals in, that's cool for that too. That's their decision. Do you know what I mean? It's all cool. It's all gravy.
What?
I don't know where I'm going with any of this. No, sorry. I'm very confused. Yeah. We're all very confused.
I wanted to set the record straight, though, because I think
short
Flax...
of it, Sips lives at 17
yeah.
Evergreen
okay,
Terrace.
Okay, and occasionally
Jersey.
After I take a shower, I stroll into my bedroom fully naked as well. So please do not look into my house ever, pretty much, is what I'm saying to you.
If you want to catch him naked, you just need to be there at 9:30 on a
Tuesday
morning.
Get your binoculars out. I have a very small penis. Like, it'll be really hard to see from far away.
And he'll be drawing the curtains. And and that's not a euphemism either.
No, yeah. Fucking, I'll be peeling them back.
Crikey. So, wow.
So, I'm glad that we've got things straight there, because I didn't want to leave the podcast today with Flax thinking that I was like some sort of weirdo.
And it's some crazy exhibitionist.
Some crazy
like,
sort of exhibitionist,
I just think
which
if
I'm not,
gonna,
for the record.
If you're going to paint a scenario, the broad strokes is too much. You've
right,
got to be
okay.
specific.
Right.
That's what I'm saying.
Well, I just like, I feel pressed for time sometimes, you know? You got to
see. Oh, we got ages. Jeez.
You got to say things quick, you know, because like we want to move on and stuff. So I didn't want
to
spend.
We ain't got nothing to say. Nothing's happened in
a
whole week. We've got no. It's all right. Like, so, I mean, I think there was a time when I was definitely more protective of my nudity.
Yeah,
do you know
that's,
I mean?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. When
sense,
I was younger, I was for
like,
sure. Like,
I was very paranoid
okay,
about, like,
if you go to a public
like,
pool,
you know,
there's no pandemic, okay? Pools are open. You go to a public pool. You happen to go at a very busy time. You're in the changing room getting changed. For example, when I was younger, I would seek out a cubicle, or I would put the towel around me and like change under my towel, right? Now I find that I'm older. I just don't give a fuck anymore. I'm just fully fucking naked and whatever.
Don't get me wrong. I'm doing it as quickly as I can, and I don't want anyone
sure,
to see.
Sure, yeah. I'm not going like at a leisurely pace.
I'm not like super shy.
I have
shy.
Intent to
gonna,
actually get out of there. I don't want to spend more time in there than I need to.
I want to take as little time, but at the same time, I don't want to accidentally like fall and stack it and have my cock and balls roll out across. Right.
I mean, yeah, that's always a concern.
What an
image. But
you rolling
know
around
I mean?
On your like, back like a turtle. Why isn't anyone helping me?
I feel like it's a thing that happens when you're older, though. Right? Because like every time I've been into a changing room, there's always some old dude like, and it's all hanging out and he doesn't give a fuck.
He is,
right?
No, but he's the opposite though. He's always been
like, no, he's gotten
guy,
in there
like,
after the pool and most people will shower with their bathing suit still on. Not him. He's fully fucking nude and he's showering.
And he's not turned away either. You don't get a shot of his ass.
And he takes,
you get a shot
takes
of
no
the
time,
ball.
takes all the time in the world yes. to get dressed. Yeah.
And they're just out all the time. Like he's not even making it. It's like he's not even brought a towel with him. He's just air
and
drying.
He's using body wash like all over his face and head and hair everywhere. He's just completely smothered in body wash, like foamy body wash.
It's like being at the zoo.
Yeah.
But surely. The same argument goes, which is just don't look.
Well, exactly.
No,
I don't.
But that is not the argument.
I notice because sometimes I'll walk in and be like, whoa, and then I look away sort of thing.
Oh, naked old man.
He's welcome to do that in a cubicle. If he's welcome to have his cock and balls out in his own little cubicle. But as long as I don't peek behind the curtain.
Look at those balls.
You know, do you know what I mean? Like, I'm just, I think we're all on the same page here,
are.
Fellas.
Yeah, I think we are. Yeah.
I hate having to get naked in public. Like in a change room or something. It's just
I hate it.
Fucking hate, I hate it. Like I used to hate at school when they'd make us take the showers. None of us did. There were like two guys in our whole class that would get naked.
If I think I'm going to be going in the sea or in the swimming pool, I'll just wear my trunks underneath my jeans. For
the guys
day.
That got naked were just always so guys that were on somewhere. Professional sports teams. So they had a lot of experience with just being naked around each other all the time, it seemed. You know what I mean?
You know what the weird thing is? I remember the kids in our class who used to get naked after PE and shower. And the rest of us would just wet our hair because the teacher would check. Like, he would come in and check and be like, everybody got your hair wet? Yeah, you all got your hair wet. And we'd all have wet hair and be bone dry underneath because we'd just run into the shower, wet our hair, and then come back out again. The guys that would get naked, they weren't like the popular kids or the jocks. Oh. Just two random kids. I can't even remember their names.
Ours were
I was at school with them for 6 years.
Ours were like
they're probably
Brad
the least
Chad,
sweaty ones
like,
as well.
Like super Chad, like big jocks. Like they were on the football team or they were like hockey players or whatever.
Really? It was the other way around for you? Okay. No.
Oh, the people who weren't like that wouldn't even go into the locker room. Because they, because Brad and Chad would like fucking turbo wedgie them and pick on them and stuff like that. That's just how it worked at my school. You were either Brad and Chad, so like the dominating alpha preteen, or you were just somewhere in the middle. And Brad and Chad, you weren't on their radar really.
You were a weenie.
Or you were like nerds that just never went anywhere near the locker room because Brad and Chad would. Prey on you like the whole
weenie
time.
Loves ass.
I mean, the school I went to was a grammar school. You had to pass an exam to get in, and we were meant to be. If you were in that school, you were like the top 13% of Bournemouth, right? Everybody else went to like non grammar schools. It was we were meant to be like the smart ones. Some of the kids that were in there. Oh my God. Like, I was just like, you must have lucked your way through the exam.
Well,
there's
probably
no
their parents had connections or money or whatever.
No, there
like,
was, that was
a
not
that.
A factor. That really wasn't a factor. And these kids were not from well-to-do backgrounds.
No, there's no backpatching and corruption in that
system
at all.
That's definitely the case. They're not just gonna get it.
So a kid from a council estate who got into the school and was thick as shit, genuinely, He his parents scratched the back of the teachers.
Oh,
maybe they saw something that they weren't supposed to see.
What if
ever think of that flex?
You're right.
You know,
I
love that
right.
Sims jumps to the conspiracy.
The thing is,
I
like,
love that.
Half the kids there from council estates were like the smart kid on the council estate. Who was like, this
yeah,
is
their maybe
shot
their
out.
Dad was a window cleaner, climbed up the window one time and looked into one of the teacher's bedrooms while they were getting changed after a shower and saw something.
But
he
the,
was
the
not
other
meant
half
to
of the
see.
Kids that were there from council estates were honestly, I just wondered, holy shit, like, what are you doing here? They just fought all the time.
Yeah.
They hated the teachers. It was just like, what's going on? Like it was bizarre.
This is a good thing to have. And I think there is some element of giving sort of low income families support to get into good schools because once they're in, a lot of them do do just as well.
Yeah.
And like, it's a great 100%. Leveler. Like.
And crucially, they become very good jurors later on in life.
Well, also the way exams... The way exams work is that exams greatly favor people, kids whose families could afford to be tutored and trained up and stuff like this, right? And so these exams for kids are disproportionately affect, you know, low income families. And so, you know, you do have to have some affirmative action, if you like, in there to bring, you know, representatives of you know,
I don't think we have that. I don't think that was why they were there.
I think there were some. I remember a couple of kids at my school were low income kids on scholarships and stuff. And there were some programs, and I hope they do exist still and do stuff.
I'm
like
sure
that.
They do. They have to. I mean, honestly, otherwise the schools that these kids were going to go to, some of them were fucking awful, like genuinely awful. There were definitely people there that I thought, what actually are you doing here? I mean, I'm not doing well at school, but you know, these kids just seemed like. On another level of
some of the biggest wankers in my school were the rich ones.
Oh yeah, I mean, 100%.
Oh yeah, for us it was Brad and Chad. They were the worst.
We didn't have jocks really.
Jocks were just the fucking worst.
We had a couple of absolute assholes who would basically go into nightclubs since they were 15.
We had the whole fucking initiation van and everything. Like we had
initiation van.
Yeah, jocks with like cricket paddles in a van. They would drive around on the first day of school and get people and like smack their butts with cricket paddles.
Jesus.
And stuff. Like it was just they were the worst. Like they were, I don't know, it was just, I guess it's like a cultural thing or whatever.
Fuck,
like
we never had that.
Luckily I never was I never had any of that done to me, but like it definitely happened. Wedgies.
Were you doing it? Lots were you in the van?
No, I wasn't in the van either. Lots of wedgies, locker room, like stories of like mega wedgies in the locker rooms and stuff like that. You know, people like holding somebody down and farting in their face and dumb shit like that. Like it's all that kind of stuff. It's always jokes.
It's horrible. It's horrible, but also like such a kid thing, such a schoolboy thing to do, isn't it? Getting your head flushed in a toilet.
Yeah,
or something.
Yeah. There's all that shit. And it was always jocks because like you had the groups in high school. When I went to high school, was you were either a jock, you were like really either a jock. You were either really academic and you hung out with like gifted people and you had like different classes to everybody else. Or you were like a skater, and most skaters were like stoners, or you were just a full on stoner who didn't even skate because you were so stoned all the time. You couldn't even do the physical. Like,
there's always that spectrum, isn't there? There's always the guy who is the most stoned.
Yeah. Yeah. And those are pretty much the groups. Like there wasn't really, there weren't like
they
too many in-betweeners
at the end of year medals. Do you know what I mean? Like, you know, head boy, you know, best talented, best maths. And then like most stoned.
Those guys had their own society.
Heads
like
flushed
the,
down toilets.
Like the high achievers,
do you know what I mean?
And stuff. They never mixed with anyone else. Like they were just
never had any of this
in the
stuff.
Cafeteria. They had their own tables that they sat at together and
no
stuff.
Way.
Nobody really bugged them. It was only when there was like a prison. Like gym class. So and like if somebody was like exceptionally bad at physical education, they would like get picked on in the locker rooms and stuff.
They form
like
their little cliques, like and in order to survive, that's what it is. Yeah. You know,
this is so weird. This is so alien compared to my school experience. I felt like we were more, because first of all, everybody has to wear a uniform. So that kind of removes a lot of the character, if you like, behind what people, you don't know what they're like, because they're just wearing the same fucking suit as you.
In North America, we didn't have school uniforms either. So clothes were a huge thing. Fashion clothes, like, you know, if you weren't wearing like the right clothes, in certain circumstances, you'd get picked on a lot. Like it was, there's lots of that.
See, I think that's. I mean, I know that people. I know, especially in America. I remember The Simpsons did a bit about school uniforms, where they're like making fun of school uniforms in a way, because it was like the whole point was, and the kids are wearing them, they're all basically turned into robots and everything.
Yeah.
But there is a massive upside. I mean, we definitely couldn't have afforded good clothes for me at school. I looked like shit. Like my clothes were really bad.
Yeah.
Thinking about now, I look at pictures, I'm like, oh my God, like awful. If I had to wear that to school, and there would have been definitely kids there who were dressed up really nicely, I would have thought, Jesus Christ, I feel like an absolute piece of shit now. It would have been awful. The school uniform made it much simpler.
The school uniforms is the cooler you were, the shabbier your school uniform was, right? You wore it as badly as you could without getting caught. Do you know what I mean? You'd have, you know, like loose tie, like shirt untucked, just like as messy as possible.
Fighting the,
like,
the people
who wore it smart that were the squares. Do you know what I mean?
But you know what? There were also the squarest squares in our school were the kids who seemed to add to their school uniform, like a waistcoat. They'd wear like a
propeller cap and a briefcase.
Yeah, and I was like, Jesus, like a bow tie. You know, it's like, what the fuck? Yeah. Like, these guys are all in on the uniform thing. And they were all like teachers' pets, and all of them were.
Yeah.
Or a briefcase.
Yeah,
know,
briefcase is a
stuff.
Dead giveaway. You got a briefcase. Come on.
Yeah.
You're not a businessman. You're at school with the rest of us.
Classic.
What's in there? The same shit that's in my bag. You haven't got papers from the office you're taking home to work on overnight. You're at fucking school. You don't need a briefcase. It's ridiculous.
We used to have like, all our hallways were just lined with lockers too, which is, I guess, probably the same at every school.
I never had a locker. I guess you had to pay for them.
Yeah, so we all had lockers, but I remember my locker was basically just like a lunch dumping ground. And at the end of the year, every year, you'd have to clean out your locker because you got issued a new one like the next year or whatever. So like the last day of school was always like everybody cleaning out their lockers. And I remember me and like a couple of my friends, our lockers were close by, and like the whole hallway stunk because there was just like these old fucking lunches that had gone moldy like in all of our lockers.
God, that's so disgusting.
So gross. Fuck. It was so
there was
gross.
The mythical locker filled with copies of the Daily Sport that we had in our school.
Oh, yeah.
And
yeah.
If you were very lucky, someday someone would find the key, open it up, and like, I don't know, pass them around, like, put them back in there for another 3 months or whatever. I don't know. I saw someone
on Twitter about a boys' school next to a girls' school. So mine was a boys' school of about 1,000 kids, and there was a girls' school of, I think, about 800 kids just across the field. And it was like a big playing field, like when schools used to have like vast playing fields. It was huge. But at lunchtime, there was a cricket pavilion bang in the middle, and it was kind of falling into disrepair. But the boys and the girls, that was the border. And thinking back now, they would have to put teachers, like border guards, on a line along that border, making sure that there was no intermingling between the boys' school and the girls' school.
Wow.
And thinking back now, how fucking cruel is that?
Mr. Gorbachev,
tear down your wall. Exactly. It's like, you kidding me? You're separating kids from other kids just because some are boys and some are girls? What do you think there's going to be? We're going to have a fucking set up an emergency birth clinic in the pavilion because everyone's going to be banging so hard. There's going to be babies spitting out of every corner. Calm down.
We had a couple of all-girls schools. I think it was mostly all-girls schools as opposed to like all-boys schools. Like, in Canada, I mean, I don't know. I didn't really know anybody who went to any of these schools or whatever, but it was for like the elite. Like, it wasn't, you didn't just like go there if you were like middle class or whatever. This was like, you know, if you went to these schools, you were fucking stinking rich sort of thing. All of our schools were mixed, no uniforms, nothing. The separator for our schools was that you had different boards of education. So like, I was in a board of education that was like focused on like French immersion. So for like English speaking, English born kids in Canada who wanted to become bilingual by the time they were ready to work, sort of thing, fully bilingual. So like all of my classes were in French, everything. Like, I,
so are you, can you speak fluent French?
Yeah, I'm rusty as hell though. I never use it. Like, I can understand it. Like, I can watch French news and understand everything. Like, I can have like a conversation in French, but I'll just sound like crazy because it's all
the grammar and
sentence structure is all different. But like, what I'll just do like a one for one translation sort of thing. So like,
mon Dieu,
none of what I say sounds like properly French because I'm just using English sentence structure and stuff.
Do they understand though if you speak to a French person in Sipsian French?
They'll understand. Yeah, like it's fine. Like if I practiced, I'd be a lot better, but I just I never do.
That's interesting. I never knew that about you.
Okay, but the other school board was like a religious school board. So you had a handful of schools that were like part of like a Catholic school board. So they had different, they had different time off, they had different holidays and stuff. It wasn't like in the UK, everything's happens at the same time for school, right? Half term is the same for everybody, whatever. But we would be off and they would be at school still. So like,
to be fair, that They also, the schools around here have different half terms.
Oh, right. Okay.
Like, one of my eldest friends called around and was like, you know, is she there? And I was like, no, she's at school. And they were like, oh, we have half term this week and we're at school next week. So there are differences.
Oh, okay. I thought it was like all across the country. Cause like, I know,
I think it tends to be around the same time.
Mine are like here.
Right.
You know, there are definitely differences.
Yeah.
But yeah, so we used to go to like this other high school and you're like, we'd be off and they'd be at school. So we'd go to their school and wait for them to come out at lunch or whatever and hang out with them and stuff. And vice versa, they'd be off, we'd be at school and they'd come over and stuff. So it was like,
right. You
had that crossover, but you know, it wasn't like a boy girl thing. It was just like the different school boards, but
one of my favorite comments, I think it was on Twitch ever that I saw about me in a stream was, someone said, I quite like Pyrion, but I have a feeling he'd just stare at my tits. And it's always stayed with me because it's probably true. Well, but I honestly think the part of it is having...
What are you talking about? You're the man with the iron gaze. You're the guy who didn't stare at that woman's tits or Dota, but famously, that's your like nickname.
Yes,
is that you,
but that was when I was on camera being a professional, Lewis.
Right.
All right. Off camera, I was all over those tits. I was staring at those tits nonstop. They were right there, dude. Like, you know, you saw the picture. You couldn't miss them. I definitely copped a big eyeful of boobs off camera, but I keep it professional. That's the point.
Right,
is when
see.
I'm being professional, I'm being professional. When I'm not being professional, I do stare at tits. I can't help myself. 6 years in a boys' school, starved of being able to see boobs. I'll do that to a guy.
Seven years.
I'm a product of my environment.
I had 7 years in a boys' school. You know this.
Do you stare at tits?
I can't stop myself.
Exactly.
I'm addicted.
So I'm saying, but if I'm on camera and I've been asked to do a job, Lewis, I'm a professional.
Really messed me up.
I'm a professional.
Well, it's fine. I'm glad we got that all out of our system.
Yeah, that was nice. Yeah. That was very therapeutic for me. I like that.
I mean, that was it, though, being in an all-boys school for a long time.
Fucking hate it. And now I've sent my eldest to a girls' school because it's a good school.
But, I heard girls are even worse to each other than
yeah,
the
they're pretty
are.
Bad. My sister went to a girls' school and she would come home every day and she would complain about some group of friends who she wasn't talking to. And I would get really angry. My mum always tells me, like, you would be absolutely raging because my reaction would be like, but you were friends with them yesterday. What changed? Why are you now enemies? I said, and tomorrow you're going to be friends again. This is ridiculous. And she'd be like in tears about some breakup with a group of friends. The next day, it's like it never happened. It's so weird.
That's like kids for you, though. That happened all the time with us.
I never did that.
Really?
I have my group of friends. I was like a group of friends. That's it. Occasionally, we'd have a little disagreement. It'd be gone in a couple of days.
I don't think I've really even like fallen out with anyone in a sense. Do you know what I mean? Like, I've never really had an enemy in a sense, or someone who's, I feel like they've, I don't know, wronged me somehow or done a thing. Even like girlfriends that I've broken up with, it's never really been that sour, you know? It's always been like, I don't know, like it feels weird to have that level of drama in your everyday life. And it definitely was like that with the girls that I knew from the girls' school who were on the bus. We were all just so, I don't know, so much, much meaner
they
to each other.
They were very mean to each other, yeah.
Really interesting.
But I wonder if part of it is it's much less likely to resort to violence, which, I mean, I had fights at school for sure, not many.
Oh, yeah? Okay, I did have a couple.
Yeah, we had fights. I think that in a way...
I had fights when I was, like, younger. Like,
yeah, exactly.
Like, much younger. Like, when I was, like, 9, 10, like, we'd have fights
right.
at school. But, like, in high school, I would never had fights.
No, I hardly ever. But we did have a few. But it was generally... That was the catharsis. That was what settled it in a weird way. I'm not advocating violence. I'm just saying that I think boys tend to just go to fisticuffs, whereas girls just get bitchier and bitchier. That's a massive generalization.
There were a couple of people I didn't like, actually. Now I'm thinking about it. Yeah, but it was definitely a 0 to 100 when you're a kid, when you're a boy, though. When you're like, you know, it's almost like someone says something really now thinking about how stupid it is. You know, someone calls you some stupid name. And
it's a fight. Yeah, there's going
to
be a fight.
And suddenly, like, you go from 0 to 100. You're like raging. Whereas I don't know if girls like bottle it up or like kind of store it up, or I don't know.
Yeah,
whether,
if you where, go, I tell you I what, le, the ladies that are watching this, if you went to a girls' school, if fighting was a regular thing at your school, let us know. I certainly don't remember my sister getting into fights.
We have
school.
No perspective. It was very of what rare. Goes on in there,
yeah.
And it's like we just think of it as this wonderful, angelic, you know, Harry Potter style place, right? Full of
where they're all handing each other posies of flowers and complimenting their hair and stuff like that. You know, that kind of shit. I certainly remember there were fights all the time in the boys' school, and we would all just watch. I mean, it was great. It was like the highlight of playtime was.
It wasn't that was, much was fighting, fighting. But it was. It happened occasionally, but I'm sure there must be fights in girls' school as well. But
it must
just
be.
Maybe it's just different. It's a mysterious world. We're never going to know.
Who knows that's what enough. They're thinking?
Who knows?
Yeah.
That's the thing. We'll never figure it out.
I'm not sure I really even want to know. Actually, I'm quite happy being ignorant. I'm never going to understand women.
Well,
anyway,
then
so.
We're all very happy.
37 years. Maybe in another 37, I'll understand women.
Nah.
Ah, yes. I finally understand.
Ah, yes, women's. Ask me anything. I'm around for 2 hours.
Women, I understand you now. I have comprehension of your people. That's what we'll achieve enlightenment at some point.
Thanks, everyone, for listening. We'll see you next week.
Yes.
Have a good one. Look after yourselves.
Yeah. Goodbye.
Bye.
Bye.